Good afternoon once again. Welcome to the final hearing today on that will be involving the United States. We've had several today. This one is on human rights situation of children victims of sex trafficking and sexual exploitation in the United States of America. Very important topic. And this hearing was requested by the Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights Projects for Girls. This afternoon, I have with me former president of the commission, Commissioner Felipe Gonzalez, to my left. Well, everybody is to my left. And I also have with me the Commissioner Rosa Maria Ortiz, who is the rapporteur for the rights of the child, so she would be very interested in this, and also Assistant Executive Secretary Elizabeth Abimershed, Rosemary Antoine, President of the Commission. We will give each of you 20 minutes to make your presentations, and then we will take some questions and hopefully have time for a few more comments. Please begin. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Madam President, Commissioners, Assistant Executive Secretary Abimershed, representatives of the Government of the United States. My name is Angelita Baez, and on behalf of the Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights and my colleagues here at this table, we are very pleased that the Commission is interested in hearing this very important topic. Joining me at the table is Kerry Kennedy, President of Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights, as well as Malika Saada Saar and Jasmine Vafa from the Human Rights Projects for Girls, and Holly Burkhalter from the International Justice Mission. As my colleagues will elaborate further today, there's more than 1,000 children that are arrested on prostitution and related charges every year in the US and that are placed in juvenile detention facilities. Instead of recognizing them as victims of sex trafficking and exploitation, they're treated as perpetrators. I will now ask my colleague Malika Saada Saar to further elaborate on this issue.
Thank you. It is an honor and privilege to be here with you. I'm Executive Director of Rights for Girls, a human rights organization focused on gender-based violence in the United States. I want to thank you for giving attention and voice to the crisis of domestic child sex trafficking here in the US. As a human rights lawyer, I have witnessed how children trafficked on American soil have been left behind. According to the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, there are at least 100,000 American children trafficked for sex each year. The majority of them are girls who are of middle school age. They are disproportionately poor, African American, and Latino. Many of the girls are also children in our foster care system. They are children who are under the state's care and custody. One survivor explained to me how the foster care system is a convenient supply chain for traffickers. Quote, "In most of my 14 different placements in foster care homes," she said, "I was raped and attached to a check. I understood very early that I could be raped, cared for, and connected to money. It was therefore easy to go from that to a pimp. And at least the pimp told me that he loved me." These girls are abducted or lured by traffickers. They are routinely raped, beaten into submission, and sometimes even branded. Yes, branded, like cattle. A few months ago in Los Angeles, I met a girl whose trafficker branded the letters of his name onto her face. Across the United States, there are child sex markets similar to those in Cambodia, Thailand, and India. Girls are sold in this country with the same disregard for human dignity, and they are often tortured in the same ways when they try to escape. They are girls like Aviva. Aviva was in the foster care system. At the age of 14, a trafficker kidnapped her. He held Aviva hostage for almost a year. During that time, she was sold to at least 10 different men a night. Aviva was purchased and raped so many times in a day that she didn't understand what the point was of putting on her underwear. She forgot what it felt like to be human, and she did not understand how adult men wanted to buy her body when she was still only a child. When law enforcement finally intervened and found Aviva, she was not treated as a victim of crime. She was arrested for prostitution at the age of 15. Too often, American children bought and sold for sex are not contemplated as victims of trafficking. They are instead considered child prostitutes. Every year, more than 1,000 children are arrested for prostitution in the U.S., even though most of these children are not of the legal age to consent to sex. Because these children are seen and treated as child prostitutes and not victims of child rape, they are denied all the legal protections and supports afforded to other sexually assaulted minors. They are shackled, arrested, and placed into detention. Law enforcement has failed to establish consistent protocols to treat trafficked children as victims of child abuse. These children are not interviewed by sexual violence experts, as is done in other instances of child rape. Nor do prosecutors provide them the legal protections afforded to other sexually assaulted minors. Something is terribly wrong when a child whose rape has been paid for is seen and treated as less of a victim of rape. There should be no difference between the legal rights and protections afforded to a child who is raped and the child who is purchased for rape. We cannot continue to arrest and detain children for prostitution. It makes no sense to incarcerate an abused child for the abuses perpetrated against her. This is an absolute human rights violation, and we look to the larger international human rights community to help us end this unjust criminalization of children subject to commercial serial rape. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to be with you today. My name is Yasmin Vafa, and I am the Director of Law and Policy for Human Rights Project for Girls. The seminal piece of anti-trafficking legislation in the United States is the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, or the TVPA. First passed in the year 2000, the TVPA has been subsequently reauthorized a number of times, most recently in 2013. The TVPA makes clear that minors under the age of 18 induced to perform a commercial sex act are victims of sex trafficking. Despite this fact, states throughout our country continue to arrest and detain child victims of sex trafficking for the victimization that they have endured. Each year, more than 1,000 children are arrested for prostitution in the United States, and many of these children are not even old enough to provide consent to sex, let alone commercial sex. Due to growing recognition of this injustice, in recent years, we have seen advocates push states to adopt what is known as safe harbor legislation, or legislation that would prohibit the prosecution of minors for prostitution offenses. To date, only 15 states nationwide have adopted some form of safe harbor, but these laws vary greatly as to protection and scope. For instance, some of these laws only encompass children under the age of 16. Others provide merely an affirmative defense to a prostitution charge. Others divert children into our child welfare systems, while others provide full immunity from suit. The TVPA has even provided model safe harbor legislation for states to follow in order to prevent the prosecution of child victims. But the fact remains that in the vast majority of U.S. states, these children continue to be put behind bars for their victimization. The criminalization of these youth demonstrates the intersectionality of discrimination that is based on gender, race, and socioeconomic status by both law enforcement and the criminal justice system. According to the Federal Bureau of Investigations, over 60% of all prostitution-related arrests for minors in the U.S. involve African-American girls, and this is more than any other racial group. These prejudices around gender and race can also influence decisions made from the time of arrest through adjudication and on to sentencing. The impact of incarceration on this population can also not be ignored. Once detained, these youth are subject to conditions of confinement that only exacerbate their existing trauma. Traditional means of asserting authority, such as the use of restraints, solitary confinement, and strip searches, can serve to re-traumatize victims of sexual and physical violence. Moreover, when these girls are incarcerated for the experience of being serially raped and propertied, they have difficulty returning to their families and their communities. The criminal records that follow these victims also serve to limit their ability to access future employment, education, and housing. Finally, services for American victims of child sex trafficking in the United States are scarce. Simply put, there are more animal shelters in the United States than programs and beds for these child victims. Where few programs do exist, there is no standard of care to dictate the array of services needed or the quality of care for services rendered. Access to what little services are available are further hindered by incarceration, where no meaningful treatment or counseling can be obtained from behind bars. Despite all of these facts, the U.S. Department of State consistently ranks itself as a Tier 1 nation, the highest rating in its annual ranking of nation states and their overall response to human trafficking. The simple fact is that other countries are doing more for their child trafficking victims. Surely, the United States can work to adopt policies and approaches that at least match what other member states are doing to protect our youth. Thank you.
Thank you for including me at this important hearing. My name is Holly Burkhalter, and I'm with International Justice Mission, and I'm going to give a little bit of a different perspective than my colleagues on the panel. We do not work on trafficking issues in the United States, but we do work with governments to combat child sex trafficking and other crimes against the poor and vulnerable in lots of other countries other than the United States, including several countries in the Western Hemisphere. And what I'd like to talk with you about is the way that child protection standards have developed, at least in my time in the field, and reflecting on my last 9 or 10 years working on the issue of sex trafficking, because I think it provides a real perspective on what the growing industry standards are and how far away from those standards the United States is falling. As we work in, we have worked on sex trafficking, and by working, I mean we represent individual children who were rescued from prostitution with the assistance of my organization, always working in collaboration with local governments. When you're rescuing someone or helping someone who is a victim of a violent crime, that is not something you freelance. You always collaborate with the authorities, and we have done so, including in places that are very poor and had very broken and infirm and weak justice systems, but all of them were able to improve quite dramatically in the course of training and engagement and resources and companionship on the part of my organization and others. If you take a look at the country of Guatemala, for example, where IJM has worked for the past 8 years working with the authorities on child sexual assault, meaning just common garden variety rape, which is very common. When we first began working with the government of Guatemala, they were not child protection or child-friendly standards, simply because they didn't know. They didn't have best practices going into the courtroom. A little child would be facing an adult, usually a relative or a near neighbor, who had been the assailant, and things would not go well. But over the course of particularly the last 3 or 4 years, the government of Guatemala has adopted best practice standards for child protection in the process of investigating and prosecuting these crimes. And now, you know, there's never a circumstance where a child would go to court without a trusted social worker by his or her side. There would never be an occasion, not one, where a child who's the victim of rape would go to jail. And the thing that's exciting about this is these are not NGO standards created in a vacuum. These are standards and practices now that are becoming normative in the hemisphere and elsewhere that are developed with governments, with police, with prosecutors, and are now becoming normative. We see even in the countries where we're newly engaging, such as the Dominican Republic, where we have our first sex trafficking office in the United in the hemisphere. And even the government knows it has a problem with teens in the commercial sex industry and is eager to do better, has a special designated prosecutorial unit. And we just did a collaboration to rescue a number of teen girls from prostitution last week with the Dominican authorities. And what I want to share with you is the way the girls were received and interviewed is a stark contrast to the way many American girls are treated when they are not rescued from prostitution, but arrested for prostitution. And again, this is a country that is on the early part of the curve and does not have vast resources. They have very few, as a matter of fact. But at the time of the rescue of the victims, social workers were present because, of course, they would be frightened. They were first interviewed by a government-trained forensic psychologist with interview tactics that are state of the art. The government is collaborating with my organization for a special reception center so that girls do not go to the regular police station where you're mixed up with the accused and it's frightening and re-traumatizing. And this is all just within our first half year of collaboration. Now, this is not to say that the Dominican Republic or any of the developing world countries that IJM collaborates with have state-of-the-art in every possible way. No, there are resource constraints particularly. Shelters need to be brought up to standards. But these are governments that recognize that and are eager to do so. I'll tell you, the place that has probably changed the most and the most dramatically in the last 12 years that went from being ground zero for child sex trafficking and for grotesquely poor treatment of child victims in the courtrooms and in the police stations was Cambodia. But today, Cambodia is you won't believe it, but it is a model of best practice for child protection in every single aspect of rescue and a social worker to walk the child through every part of the judicial process. No child goes to jail for crimes that committed against them or crimes they may have committed ancillary to their victimization. Now, this is, you know, it does seem to me that when a country as poor and as broken as Cambodia that does not have a perfect human rights record by any stretch, no one would hold them up as a model of good governance. But when that country can say, we're going to do right by these little kids, and we're going to make a run at this and make this right, and then they do so, that is something to look at and recognize and certainly to celebrate. So when I wanted to note that children can be re-traumatized in shelters. Not all shelters are good. Many are bad. There's a long way to go in our country and here in the United States and elsewhere. But at a bare minimum, children should not be incarcerated and should not go to jail because, as you all know, juvenile detention is not a safe place for children. I remember from my early days at Human Rights Watch, one of my previous places where I worked for many, many years, and I remember the reports that were done on sexual assault in juvenile detention of guards, of prison guards, of teachers, of other inmates, and these conditions can persist to this day in juvenile detention. And if you also keep in mind what Malika said, so many of these girls that are being pimped are already victims of sexual assault. We see this in our own work in the countries where the six countries where we work on child sexual assault. Those little girls and boys have a bullseye on their back when they have been victimized at home and have been betrayed by people they should trust, and they are very easy picking for traffickers. And the United States justice system has got to recognize that fact and create protection for those children, because they will be re-traumatized in prison under the best of circumstances. It's worthy of note in the TIP report, which for those of us in the anti-trafficking movement is something of our Bible. And as a practicing Christian, I have to say that with some care, that the TIP report is the anti-trafficking, but it is full of extraordinarily fine work, and I'm extremely proud of my good friends and colleagues who write this. And I just quickly leaf through there to look at all the countries where IJM AM in the Western Hemisphere is either actively working or has close partnerships. So I looked quickly at the reports of the, in the 2014 document from Guatemala, Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, and the DR. And each of them had this to say: there were no reports of victims being punished for unlawful acts committed as a direct result of being subjected to human trafficking in those countries. But of course, we know there are 1,000 instances in the United States. And I leave you with that thought. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Holly. Thank you, Holly. Honorable members of the commission, the U.S. government's failure to protect child victims of sex trafficking is a violation of its obligations under international law. As Holly just pointed out, every day children go to a jail, 1,000 children a year, for crimes not that they committed, but for crimes committed against them. This is unacceptable in the United States of America. By ratifying the optional protocol to the Convention on the Rights of the Child on the Sale of Children, Child Prostitution, and Child Pornography, the U.S. has bound itself to, quote, to adopt appropriate measures to protect the right and interest of child victims by recognizing their vulnerability, adapt criminal procedures, and provide them with appropriate support and services while in the judicial system, unquote. That same instrument requires additional training for law enforcement officers and judges dealing with child victims of sex trafficking in order to ensure that the best interests of the child are taken into account. The U.S. is also a party to the protocol to prevent, suppress, and punish trafficking in persons, especially women and children, and therefore has the obligation to adopt concrete measures to assist and protect victims of trafficking. Under the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, the U.S. must stop any discriminatory practice. And under the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, it has to respect the right to be free from arbitrary arrest and detention. Finally, by failing to protect these children from sexual exploitation, and by subsequently failing to provide them with adequate care and rehabilitation, the United States has violated its obligations under the American Declaration of the Rights and Duties of Man. In particular, the U.S. has breached its provisions pertaining to the right to life and personal security, the right to equality before the law, the right to protection for mothers and children, and the rights to a fair trial and due process of law. In light of these failures, we urge the United States to comply with its international human rights obligations and to ensure that not one more child victim of sex trafficking or sexual exploitation suffers further injury at the hands of the very authorities responsible for protecting them. To achieve this goal, we recommend the adoption of the following measures. One, the federal guidance to state and local law enforcement in the form of a directive by the Attorney General on the implementation of the TVPA. Two, federal guidance from the Department of Justice on the protocols for protecting child victim witnesses in prosecutions against traffickers, including at the state and local levels. This guidance should be expressly condemned the detention of child victims in juvenile facilities as material witnesses. Three, the DOJ should convene survivors, experts, law enforcement, and child welfare and juvenile justice officials to develop standards of care for victims of child sex trafficking. Four, federal guidance for law enforcement on responding to children victims of sexual trafficking and exploitation. This guidance should specify that any child identified by law enforcement as a victim of child sex trafficking should not be arrested and detained, and should be immediately referred to appropriate service providers. Five, strengthening federal, state, and local coordination to implement the TVPA, including direct and meaningful coordination between federal, state, and local governments, and additional training for local law enforcement. We also ask the Honorable Commission to consider, one, preparing a report on the situation of child victims of sexual trafficking and exploitation in the United States. 2, conducting an on-site visit to the state of California or another state they deem appropriate in order to assess the situation of children victims of sexual trafficking and exploitation. And 3, incorporating the information presented in this hearing in its annual report, as well as any other relevant ongoing draft report. We thank you for the opportunity to present this information.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I ask the state to present?
Thank you. Distinguished commissioners, distinguished members of the commission, and representatives of the Robert Kennedy Center and International Justice Mission. My name is Anthony Pahagian, and I'm the alternate representative at the United States Mission to the Organization of American States. We believe this is a very important topic on which to end a long day of productive hearings. The United States would like to state once again, for the record, that in light of the fact that this is a thematic hearing under Article 66 of the Commission's rules and not a petition-based hearing under Article 64, the Commission should not refer to the civil society entities that requested the hearing as petitioners, including on the placard on the table in front of them, nor should it imply that this is an adversarial hearing. We thank the Commission for bringing us together on a topic critical to the United States, both domestically and internationally. We take very seriously the issues raised and have pulled together a distinguished panel from the U.S. federal government to discuss them, and the emphasis on federal, because as you are no doubt aware, the United States has a complex federalist system. We would like to emphasize that many of the issues raised at this hearing fall into the purview of state and local governments. Today, we will address only what the U.S. federal government is doing to address trafficking in persons, especially in regards to helping child victims. We are not in a position to discuss matters or field questions within the purview of all of our state and local jurisdictions. This, as you can imagine, would be very difficult in a federal system where laws vary between every U.S. state and local jurisdiction. Our delegation today will only address issues and questions within their particular agency's competency. And just to make some brief introductions, we'll start with Ambassador Patricia Boutenis, Acting Director of the Office to Monitor and Combat Trafficking in Persons at the Department of State. We also have from the Department of Justice, and in order of where they're sitting, Catherine Pierce, Senior Advisor to the Administrator from the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, Office of Justice Programs. And from the Department of Health and Human Services, we have Catherine Chan, Senior Advisor on Trafficking in Persons, from the Office of the Assistant Secretary, Administration for Children and Families. And finally, we have Jay Bischoff from the Office of the Legal Advisor of the Department of State. Although not able to participate in this hearing, we have a written statement on efforts undertaken by the Department of Justice's Child Exploitation and Obscenity Section of the Criminal Division. I'll turn this over now to my colleagues. Ambassador Boutenis.
Good afternoon. I'd like to thank you for this opportunity for the United States to speak today about the important issue of the treatment of child victims of sex trafficking and exploitation in the United States. The Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights and the Human Rights Project for Girls correctly note that the Trafficking Victims Protection Act provides that any individual under the age of 18 who is induced to perform a commercial sex act is a victim of a severe form of trafficking in persons. This is very important and in keeping with the protocol to prevent, suppress, and punish trafficking in persons, especially women and children, supplementing the Convention Against Transnational Organized Crime. And we emphatically agree that governments should not arrest, detain, or prosecute trafficking victims for acts performed as a result of being trafficked. The federal government recognizes that the criminalization of child victims of sex trafficking tragically still occurs, especially at the state and local level. Representatives from the Departments of Justice and Health and Human Services who are with me on this panel will highlight our efforts to prevent the criminalization of child victims and provide them with assistance when appropriate. Before my fellow panelists speak, allow me to briefly talk about my office's role in domestic and international anti-trafficking efforts, including with reference to addressing the trafficking of children. The Office to Monitor and Combat Trafficking in Persons is the U.S. Department of State's lead on global engagement to combat human trafficking. To summarize briefly some of the work of our office, the Trafficking in Persons Office is probably best known for the State Department's annual Trafficking in Persons Report, which one of our panelists has kindly complimented us on, which assesses efforts governments are making to prevent trafficking in persons, prosecute traffickers, and protect trafficking victims. Since 2010, we have included an assessment of the United States government's efforts in those three areas and have reported in the section on victim protection about the detention or arrest of trafficking victims, including children. In the 2014 country narrative for the United States, for example, and we note that, for example, in 2012, the most recent year for which data was available at the time, 136 males and 443 females under the age of 18 years of age were reported to the federal government as having been arrested for prostitution and commercial vice by state and local authorities, compared to 190 males and 581 females in 2011. The United States recognizes that the prosecution of child trafficking victims is a problem, remains a problem. We also provide foreign assistance to prevent human trafficking, assist governments in the prosecution of traffickers through technical assistance and training, and we support programs to assist and protect trafficking victims around the world. In 2013, Congress gave the State Department a new innovative tool to combat trafficking of children when it authorized Secretary of State John F. Kerry to conclude child protection compacts with foreign governments to help build sustainable and effective systems of justice prevention and protection. The Trafficking in Persons Office is moving forward to propose the first Child Protection Compact partnership to be developed and implemented jointly with the government of Ghana. This compact partnership will include developing a collaborative plan to implement new and more effective policies and programs to reduce child trafficking and improve child protection in Ghana. In addition, because we recognize that governments alone cannot solve this problem, the Trafficking in Persons Office works to raise awareness here and abroad about modern slavery and the U.S. government's anti-trafficking efforts, as well as to build partnerships to help strengthen those efforts. Effective anti-trafficking strategies require partnerships that integrate the experiences and guidance of survivors and reach industries, local communities, schools, religious congregations, and multilateral partners. Finally, the Trafficking in Persons Office supports the Secretary in his role as chair of the President's Interagency Task Force to Monitor and Combat Trafficking in Persons, a cabinet-level entity created by the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, which consists of 14 departments and agencies across the federal government to coordinate U.S. government-wide efforts to combat trafficking in persons. I will now turn to my colleagues from the Departments of Justice and Health and Human Services to describe the activities at their agencies, and we look forward to any questions you have. Thank you.
Good afternoon. The Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention provides national leadership to prevent and respond to juvenile crime and victimization. We provide grant support to states and local communities to develop and implement prevention and intervention programs and to improve the juvenile justice system. In addition, through the Amber Alert and Internet Crimes Against Children programs, and in partnership with the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children and the National Council on Juvenile and Family Court Judges, we provide training and technical assistance to state and local law enforcement, juvenile justice agencies, judges, victim services agencies, and youth serving agencies. The National Center for Missing and Exploited Children provides training and technical assistance on commercial sexual exploitation of children and child sex trafficking to law enforcement personnel, including Amber Alert coordinators, child abduction response teams, missing children clearinghouses, and other state, territorial, tribal, and local partners who recover child abduction victims. This past year, 7 of the International Crimes Against Children task forces received specialized training on domestic child sex trafficking through Girls Educational and Mentoring Services, or GEMS. The training provided an overview on commercial sexual exploitation of children with specific sessions on risk factors of exploited youth, victim identification and engagement, interviewing victims, effective investigations, and the impact of child sex trafficking on victims. The National Council of Juvenile and Family Court Judges National Judicial Institute on Domestic Child Sex Trafficking is the result of a partnership between my office, the National Council of Juvenile and Family Court Judges, and Rights for Girls. With input from experts across the nation, the Council created a curriculum to assist judicial officers to better understand the dynamics of domestic child sex trafficking, the laws applicable to trafficking victims, ways to identify children at risk of being trafficked, and ways to connect children to appropriate services. The first institute was held in Reno, Nevada in November of last year, with 36 judicial officers from around the country attending. The Institute provided new and experienced juvenile and family court judges with the tools they need to develop or enhance their ability to handle all aspects of these complex and very challenging cases. Judges return to their communities with greater understanding and an ability to identify children who are being trafficked or at risk of being trafficked. They also learned about effective prevention and intervention strategies to respond to the individual needs of victims, improved case outcomes, and they left with a stronger sense of their courtroom and community roles to help prevent and end domestic child sex trafficking. In 2011, the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention commissioned the National Academy of Sciences Institute of Medicine to examine the scope and severity of commercial sexual exploitation of children and sex trafficking of U.S. citizens or lawful permanent residents who are under the age of 18. The committee released its findings in 2013 and concluded that commercial sexual exploitation and sex trafficking of minors should be understood as acts of abuse and violence against children and adolescents. Minors who are commercially sexually exploited or trafficked for sexual purposes should never be treated as victims, as criminals. Identification of victims and survivors and any intervention should, above all, do no further harm to the child or adolescent. The committee also recommended raising public awareness and understanding of the problem through additional training for professionals who routinely interact with children, in the development of laws and policies that redirect young victims from arrest and prosecution to services that meet their complex needs, that state, local, and tribal jurisdictions strengthen and implement laws that hold exploiters and traffickers accountable, and that a national research agenda be undertaken to advance knowledge of the problem and to develop effective interventions to prevent children from becoming victims of exploiters and traffickers. In 2014, my office released a series of guides based on the Institute of Medicine report, Confronting Commercial Sexual Exploitation and Sex Trafficking of Minors in the United States. The guides are abridged versions of the full report targeted at different sectors of professionals to inform them about child sex trafficking and to identify solutions to address the problem. The guides are a guide for the health sector, a guide for the legal sector, and a guide for providers of victim and support services. The legal sector guide includes a section on how law enforcement professionals can help to address this problem themselves. This concludes my testimony.
To the members of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, thank you for inviting me to testify today. I'm pleased to have the opportunity to share with you the Department of Health and Human Services, or HHS's, work to prevent and end human trafficking in all of its forms. The Administration for Children and Families is responsible for implementing the department's anti-trafficking authorities under the Trafficking Victims Protection Act in coordination with other HHS divisions and federal partners. As a member of the President's Interagency Task Force to monitor and combat trafficking in persons, HHS addresses the needs of victims of and survivors of human trafficking, including child victims of sex trafficking and commercial sexual exploitation. As part of our approach, we integrate anti-trafficking responses into a number of human service systems, including child welfare, runaway homeless youth, domestic violence, refugee resettlement, and Native American community services, working with populations at high risk for trafficking. Some of the progress that we've made in this last fiscal year include increased grant funding to community-based organizations to provide services for victims of trafficking. In 2014, we received a $4 million increase in congressional appropriations, which enabled us to expand services to foreign national victims of trafficking and, for the first time, fund three new demonstration grants to serve U.S. citizen and lawful permanent resident victims of trafficking. In addition, the ACF Children's Bureau awarded $2 million in discretionary funding to strengthen the child welfare's response to human trafficking, which including building infrastructure and collaborating with other systems, including law enforcement, juvenile justice, court systems, runaway homeless youth programs, child advocacy centers, and other service providers. Also last year, the ACF Administration for Native Americans opened up its social and economic development strategies, funding opportunities to serve victims of trafficking in Native American communities. And in addition to that, we continue to build the capacity addressing the needs of victims of trafficking through ongoing training and technical assistance. In the fiscal year 2016 president's budget reflects an increase in requests for services for child victims of trafficking, including a new $15 million to further strengthen the capacity within the child welfare system. Other highlights that I wanted to bring some attention to is our effort to increase government partnerships to coordinate efforts to combat human trafficking. Last January, HHS, in partnership with the Department of Justice, Homeland Security, and a dozen other federal agencies, released a five-year federal strategic action plan on what we can do to strengthen coordination, collaboration, and capacity, not just among federal agencies, but also with state, local, and tribal entities as well. And it's the first plan of its kind, and we use it as a blueprint for what we'll be doing in the upcoming years. We've also been increasing training for healthcare professionals to better identify and serve victims of trafficking. We've increased transparency and community engagement, including supporting the Department of Justice efforts last year in holding a national survivor forum, bringing together survivors of trafficking to inform how their voices could be integrated into what federal agencies are doing. And just to close, in the upcoming year, we want to bring attention to the Preventing Sex Trafficking and Strengthening Families Act of 2014. The ACF Children's Bureau has already provided some technical assistance to U.S. states on what state child welfare systems can do to respond to child trafficking and commercial sexual exploitation. That will continue. And we are also expanding our efforts to strengthen research, program evaluation, in order to develop more best practices and standards of care to serve victims of trafficking through a number of collaborations within the Department of Health and Human Services. With that, thank you for the opportunity to testify. I'd be happy to answer any questions later.
Okay, then, thank you. Given how specific this topic is, I'm going to ask to speak first our rapporteur on the rights of the child, Commissioner Rosa Maria Ortiz.
Muchas gracias. Disculpen que voy a hablar en español. En primer lugar, muchísimas gracias a los, ¿cómo les llamo? Solicitantes de la audiencia. Muchísimas gracias por toda la información brindada, también a las autoridades de Estados Unidos. Como relatora de Derechos del Niño, estoy muy feliz de que esta audiencia se esté llevando a cabo. Me gustaría compartir con ustedes mi visión de conjunto de cómo veo a Estados Unidos en el conjunto de las Américas en este tema. No necesito repetir lo que aquí muy bien las representantes del Robert Kennedy Foundation explicaron de su sorpresa en cuanto a la reacción de diferentes estados que reciben la cooperación de Estados Unidos para abordar este problema y de qué manera el enfoque de derechos del niño de esos países ayuda a tratar de manera adecuada y dar las respuestas adecuadas y el tratamiento del niño como sujeto de derechos, tanto en su relación con el Poder Judicial como en el abordaje integral que requiere este tema. Me gustaría aprovechar la ocasión para felicitar a Estados Unidos porque realmente ha colaborado con muchos países en el mundo para abordar el tema del tráfico de niños por motivos de explotación sexual, junto con otros tipos de problemas vinculados con el crimen organizado que van muy de la mano con el tráfico de personas, como es el tráfico de drogas, tráfico de armas. Entiendo que para Estados Unidos fue muy difícil y sigue siendo muy difícil ratificar la Convención de Derechos del Niño y poder trabajar con la niñez como sujeto de derechos humanos. Se sigue trabajando como sistema de bienestar de los niños y no como sistema de protección integral de derechos del niño, lo cual es un propio proceso que vive el país, pero solo para dar un panorama de todo el mundo, en 193 países, solo Estados Unidos y Sudán del Sur no han ratificado la Convención de Derechos del Niño, lo cual, al reconocer cuánto hace Estados Unidos para apoyar a los distintos países a enfrentar este problema, crea una dificultad cuando los estados se enteran que el propio Estados Unidos todavía trata a los niños de esta forma, ¿verdad? Victimiza a quienes, no es que victimiza, sino criminaliza a los niños que son víctimas y también le da un tratamiento de adultos cuando que son niños. Otro problema que se crea es cuando se trata de hacer algo en conjunto como región de las Américas, por ejemplo, en el Instituto Interamericano del Niño, se quiere aprobar un documento en conjunto y se crean estos conflictos, no, borrar derechos, vamos a poner bienestar. Y entonces dificulta un crecimiento conjunto de todas las Américas para abordar con un enfoque de derechos que pone al niño o a la niña en el centro del análisis y del abordaje para la protección de sus derechos. Con todo esto, a los 25 años de la convención, quizás la pregunta que yo quisiera hacerles es si en 25 años ustedes ven que se podría insistir en la posibilidad de que Estados Unidos ratifique la Convención de Derechos del Niño, porque ayudaría no solamente a los Estados Unidos y todos sus estados involucrados, sino a este crecimiento conjunto de todos los países para abordar un problema tan grave como es el tráfico de niños. Reconozco y felicito a Estados Unidos porque sí ha ratificado los dos protocolos de la Convención sobre niños en conflictos armados y sobre venta de niños, y ahí se incorpora el tema de explotación sexual y tráfico. Y en ese sentido, la pregunta es si Estados Unidos está cumpliendo las recomendaciones que el Comité de Derechos del Niño les hace en materia de tráfico de niños. También quisiera decir que para la Comisión, en el informe que hicimos sobre el derecho del niño a la familia, también es muy clara la posición de la Comisión de invitar a los estados a tratar al niño desde el enfoque de derechos, como sujeto de derechos. Cuando visito diversos estados de Estados Unidos, el tema derechos del niño, el concepto derechos del niño causa problemas. O algunas autoridades me dicen, ¿derechos del niño? No, hábleme de familia y educación. Entonces, simplemente comparto esto como para invitar a sociedad civil y gobierno de Estados Unidos a hacer un esfuerzo para sumarse al resto de los países del mundo a trabajar con los niños como sujetos de derechos, ¿no? El trabajar como sujeto de derechos ayuda a la prevención en primer lugar y no a una acción reactiva de los problemas, sino sobre todo en la prevención. Elimina la figura de las instituciones que están para el bienestar de los niños y que actúan cuando el niño cae en problemas. El enfoque de derechos hace que todo el Estado se coordine y de manera sistémica responda privilegiando la prevención. Y obliga a que el tratamiento sea efectivamente el más adecuado para los niños. Y en este momento estoy a punto de terminar un informe de la Relatoría que es un aporte para Estados Unidos, que es el tratamiento de los niños como adultos en varios estados. Y agradezco mucho la apertura de las autoridades de Estados Unidos para ayudar en esto y pongo a disposición a la Relatoría de Derechos del Niño para seguir trabajando estos temas. No tengo preguntas específicas, quería aprovechar este tiempo para hacer esta reflexión porque fue muy clara la exposición también del Estado y decir que tienen en la Comisión Interamericana un interlocutor para seguir trabajando estos temas. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Commissioner Gonzalez, Rapporteur of the United States.
Thanks. Well, actually, we are approaching this issue from several points of view with the Rapporteurship of the Rights of Child, the Country Rapporteurship, and also the Rapporteurship on the Right of Migrants and Refugees, which includes our forms of human mobility, whether voluntary or forced. So it's part of the mandate of this rapporteurship that I'm in charge of as well. I think it's a very important issue that has been brought to the attention of the Commission. There seems to be an apparent conflict of laws between some of the laws at the federal level and those of some of the states of the U.S., as pointed out by the government. This is nothing new, really, at the countries of the OAS. The Commission quite often has to deal with states which are federal, to be sure all the largest states in the hemisphere are federal, and that presents further challenges, of course, and we have seen some experiences in other countries of the OAS in this regard to try to make not only the federal laws compatible with the international standards, but also the municipal laws in different countries. So that's also a challenge for the United States. And in this regard, I wanted to ask whether the judicial remedies have been brought to challenge municipal laws that might be contrary to the U.S. Federal Constitution and Inter-American instruments, but in particular within the domestic jurisdiction, where these judicial remedies, some judicial remedies have been brought or not to challenge the municipal laws that present this grave problem. Thanks.
Thank you. Well, I am quite alarmed, and I must say deeply disturbed by the information presented by the petitioners. I continue to use petitioners because we use it in the broad sense in these public hearings. it seems to me that, yes, the whole idea says federal law, but the law is not being enforced. So clearly there's a conflict. You spoke about safe harbor laws in some states, and I am obviously not as au fait with the way that the system works in the states, but it does seem to me that the federal law should have some sort of authoritative effect. I would at least ask the representative of the state to urge that the recommendations, which were very clear from the side of petitioners, be brought forward. I thought they were in terms of trying to bring that into reality, the federal law on trafficking. But also, I thought that a lot of the information we got from the state had to do with these general measures to prevent against trafficking, which are, of course, vital. But the other arm of it is how do you treat with victims of trafficking? We heard less about that, which I think is the core of the issue that the petitioners, and that is what I think disturbs me most today, that we can have over 1,000 girls and boys being arrested when they're in fact victims. And I thought we need to get more focus. The United States needs to have more focus on that aspect of the problem while still continuing its good work in trying to prevent trafficking generally, as all of us have to do. As the rapporteur for the rights of persons of African descent and against discrimination, I'm also extremely disturbed by the all too familiar connection between race and the criminal justice system and the worst aspects of the criminal justice system. We heard about that in our first hearing this morning, and this is just another dimension of it, and I would like to get more information going along about that as we proceed in terms of more statistics and just generally more information, and to see whether or not that is even acknowledged by the state, because that's one of the things we are trying to do in terms of my rapporteurship in trying to get the state to see these connections in the criminal justice system. So that's a very important aspect of it that I wanted to mention. I am not as generous as my colleague, Commissioner Ortiz, in terms of praising the United States for its work internationally. I imagine there has been some value. But at the same time, while we appreciate that the United States has been, you know, saying to other countries to ensure that they have good laws on trafficking and to prevent trafficking, it seems to me that you can't speak with any moral authority if you have this phenomenon in your own country. And certainly I come from the Caribbean, and some Caribbean states have been more or less blacklisted, let's put it that way, you know, mentioned in this report on the list. And I don't think we have even one example of this happening where a victim of prostitution has been arrested. So I think that the United States has the moral responsibility to lead by example on this issue, and it is only then it can really lead or give any sorts of traction to these issues. So it seems to me that much of the work has been outward looking, but it needs to be inward looking first, and also again not fully understanding how states and federal government works, not coming from a federal system, but also some of the partnerships that I was hearing about with Ghana and so on. We need to develop partnerships with some of these states and the state authorities. I would like to see that coming forth. I also, as a question, wanted to find out whether there has been any attempt to prosecute not the children victims of prostitution, but those who engage in the prostitution, the adults. What's happening there? Do we see any attempt at doing that? And also, I wonder if the part of the problem is that we still think of trafficking in persons as something which is cross-border. It comes across. And I wonder if that's part of the whole conceptualization of the problem, which is part of it. So I would like to hear your thoughts on that. Although we know the problem is very much internal in the United States, but also to see if we have any information about girls and boys, migrant children. Maybe not today, but we would welcome more information about that. So those are my thoughts, and just to urge the state to really take these recommendations on board seriously. We still have some time for 3 minutes each for further comments, answers to questions, and so on. Petitioners first.
Let me take some of the questions raised and comments. First, to the issue, which I think is an important one, that we contemplate this issue as cross-border. And I think that there is a learning curve for those of us in this country that this is an American problem of American children that we must be able to acknowledge. So towards that end, I know that we have done the very hard work and often in partnership with the Department of Health and Human Services and the Department of Justice in trying to create awareness that this is an American issue as well. There has to be more work done around the issue of prosecution of buyers, which I appreciate your mentioning that issue. So what happens all too frequently is that the girls are arrested more frequently. We see the traffickers arrested, but the buyers, whom we politely term as Johns, are let go. They are not arrested. And in the times that they are arrested, which is usually not the majority of times, when they are arrested, it is for misdemeanor solicitation. And our argument is that these girls have been raped, and therefore the buyer should be arrested and should be arrested on a more serious charge like statutory rape or endangerment of the child or sexual assault of a minor. We are working on that. That takes a change in policy and norms in the way that we contemplate this issue. I think it's also important to raise up that what we see playing out is part of a larger narrative of the criminalization of children and disproportionately children of color, right? So if we see these girls as children, then perhaps the way that they are treated would be different. But the problem is that too often children of color are not afforded the right to be a child and are therefore treated as adults, as if they can give consent like any other adult, or put into an adult prison, which is something that we see playing out in New York, where girls who are 17 years old who are arrested for prostitution are put into an adult facility. So it does go to the issue of who is allowed to be a child and who is afforded the protections and rights of a child. And too often, not only are boys of color, but in this situation, are girls of color are denied the right of being a child. And I think that's important to raise up. I think that the focus of having a rights-based approach to our children is absolutely a significant one that would be transformational in the way we look at our child welfare system, as well as the way that we try to move towards the end of a criminalization approach to these girls who are, in fact, victims.
I was just going to address one of the other questions that was raised. In terms of judicial challenges, I know that New York State recently, up until recently, was the only state whose appellate court had considered a challenge to the prosecution eligibility of minors. And actually, the appellate court determined that children could, in fact, be prosecuted for prostitution charges. Somewhat surprisingly, in 2010, the state of Texas and their Supreme Court took the opposite conclusion, and they concluded that because minors cannot, in and of themselves, consent to the sex act, they cannot, therefore, be prosecuted for prostitution. And so that judicial decision in Texas became the underlying foundation for what has amounted to safe harbor in the state of Texas. In terms of judicial remedies, I know that was another point that was raised. We have, similar to the movement by advocates to propagate safe harbor laws across the states, we have seen a move by advocates to for states to adopt what are being dubbed expungement statutes or vacature laws. This is, again, in recognition of the fact that so many children and also adults have been criminalized for their victimization. They allow judges to basically reverse convictions once it is proven that these convictions were a direct result of exploitation. And so that is one of the ways that we're seeing some states, again, this is not uniform, it's not everywhere, but we are seeing at the advocate level some of them trying to encourage states to adopt these vacature statutes to be able to address both children and adults being able to move on with their lives and clearing their records and sealing those records.
Okay, I can briefly address Commissioner Ortiz's question about the Convention on the Rights of the Child with information that you may already be aware of. President Clinton signed the convention in 1995, and it has not been submitted to the Senate for advice and consent to ratification yet. Given the number of other human rights instruments that the administration seeks to have ratified, and the challenges that implementing the Convention on the Rights of the Child domestically would entail, the Obama administration has not yet reached the appropriate juncture to review the treaty to determine whether to transmit it to the Senate for its advice and consent. The administration supports the goals of the convention, namely to protect the well-being of children. And as Commissioner Ortiz acknowledge, the United States has ratified the two of the optional protocols to the convention on the involvement of children in armed conflict and on child sale, prostitution, and pornography. We strongly support the implementation of those two conventions, and we report to the Committee on the Rights of the Child periodically on those two protocols, and our next report is due in January of next year, and in that report we do anticipate considering and addressing the recommendations that the committee has made to us last time and sort of also in some interim correspondence. So we're still looking at these issues and working on our response to that. And I would also point out that we have joined consensus on a number of recent Human Rights Council and UN General Assembly resolutions on the rights of children. And we joined consensus on the Human Rights Council resolution that adopted the draft protocol and a communications procedure to the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which is the third protocol to that convention. So while we remain non-parties to the convention, we strongly support its goals, and we strongly support complete ratification of the optional protocols and honor our commitments to uphold those conventions in the fullest. I don't know if any of my colleagues has any other remarks.
I'll just add one thing. Obviously, most of these are state and local cases, as the ambassador mentioned, and so can't speak to state and local prosecutions. The Department of Justice does prosecute federal cases, and we submit that data to the State Department every year for the TIP report, and that data can be shared with you, obviously.
Thank you very much, everyone, to what, again, underscore the importance of this hearing and the subject matter to all of us, but clearly, particularly so for the petition on the rights of the child. I would like to thank the petitioners for bringing the hearing to us and all the information, and also to thank the United States for its willingness, and we hope that you can do some more to ensure that your federal law is enforced throughout the United States so that you can give good leadership. Thank you again, and this is the end of this hearing.